بالله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، نعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، فإن كل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار، وإنما توعدون لآت وما أنتم بمعجزين. Last night we had spoke about the importance of Hajj, and we talk about the Umrah, and inshallah today we make an attempt to approach the Hajj steps. And talking about the Hajj with assumption that the person already had performed Umrah, which the Umrah can be performed at any time during any hour, the day or the night, but the Hajj has a special time to be performed. Therefore, with assumption that the person had already finished his Umrah, and after he finished the last thing, which was the Sa'i, or the walking between the two mountains, Safa and Marwa, that the person already had shaved or cut his hair. As a result of this, the person has the right to change his clothes and to live a normal and regular life. Now, during the month of Dhul-Hijjah, the month of Dhul-Hijjah is the last month in the Islamic calendar, and the day which is the 8th of Dhul-Hijjah, with assumption that this person already in Mecca, regardless if he one of the dwellers of Mecca or he is one of the people who had came out of Mecca and he came with Umrah, and now he been there for a days or weeks or whatever it is the condition. So this person now is going to go for Hajj. When is this person supposed to go for Hajj? The bottom line, as Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam had informed us, that Al-Hajj Arafah, attending Arafah is the main part of Hajj. If the person missed the day of Arafah, he missed the whole Hajj. He could not make up for it by any other means, not by killing an animal, not by going making extra tawaf, nothing. If a person miss Arafah, the standing on Arafah, no Hajj for him. Therefore, going to Mina in the 8th days is optional, is sunnah, is recommended. But if a person did not go out of his house, or he didn't arrive to Saudi Arabia until the 9th, and he managed to be in the city of Arafah between Dhuhr and Maghrib, this will be sufficient for him. So if a person comes directly, arrives the 9th days of the Hijjah, and he comes from the airport and he drives straight to Arafah, and he will be there before the sun set, and the person will be there during Arafah, this is the main part of the Hajj. But let's talk in general about what a person who wants to perform Hajj, what he should do. And we include the sunnah part, the optional part, and the obligatory part. The person who had went with the intention of tamattu', that means making Umrah and Hajj in the same year, we call him mutamatti', okay? in the 8th days of Dhul Hijjah, the 8th days of Dhul Hijjah, the last month of the Islamic calendar. And this day called Yawm al-Tarwiyah, the day of Tarwiyah. A person should take a shower, put perfume, and he should also put malabis al-ihram. I brought one ihram with me, but it's in the car. Inshallah, when my son Abdullah comes, I'll let him break it and I'll put it on for you to show you how. So the person will take a full shower, like any time that he taken a ghusl. He will put perfume, and only for men. Women could not put perfume during Hajj or other time. Only a woman can put perfume inside her house for her husband. Other than this, it is forbidden for her to have perfume and go outside of her house. And the person will make his intention from his spot, that means inside Mecca. Okay? He doesn't have to go outside to any other place to put his ihram. From the place where he is, he's going to wear his ihram. And as I said before, there is no any special wording for the intention. The person doesn't say, I made intention for Hajj. Nothing to say with your tongue concerning the intention. The intention is in the heart, and saying something with your tongue is not been done by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, neither by the Sahaba, may Allah be pleased with them. And after this, he will make the dhikr of labbaik Allahumma labbaik or labbaik Allahumma bihajjin. That mean, O Allah, I had answered your call with Hajj. Okay, O Allah, I reply, or I'm here, I'm your slave, I'm here at your service, and I'm here to do the Hajj that you command me with. So the person would say labbaik Allahumma bihajj, and he say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk. After this, the person will go to Mina, regardless if he's going to walk, if he's going to go in a bike, if he's going to take a motorcycle, if he goes in a taxi, in a bus, whatever means of transportation that he can take him to go to Mina. In actuality, he can walk for approximately, is about, I can say, maybe a couple of hours, he will make it there to Mina. It can be walked, and a lot of people, they walk. The only thing that is not recommended, because it's very, very hot, and the person can get sick, and the person shouldn't expose himself to any danger or anything that may cause him to be ill or sick. It is nothing wrong for the person to use umbrella, okay? What is forbidden for the person to wear a kufi, or to wear a turban, or to wear a hat? Nothing to be worn on your head that attach directly to your head, okay? But you can use a tent, you can use umbrella, you can use anything to keep the heat of the sun from you. As we said yesterday, the woman will make ihram in her regular clothes, and she is going to have her khimar over her head. And her ihram with her regular clothes that she wears does not have to be black, does not have to be white. The only thing that her ihram is in her face and her hand. That means she will expose her face and her hands. When you go to Mina, you will spend the night in Mina. Nothing especially that you will make it in Mina except dhikrullah, reciting the Quran, and make talbiyah every time you change your situation. From, as example, if you lay down, you say labbaik Allahumma labbaik. You woke up, this is what you mean by changing conditions. You say labbaik Allahumma labbaik again, okay? And after this you go walking, you say labbaik Allahumma labbaik. If you sit, any time that you change your position from moving to sitting, or from sitting to laying, or from talking to anything else, that you repeat the talbiyah again, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. And that the person will remain during this night in Mina. I don't know if I have any picture here for Mina to show you, but it's nothing really special that you will. This here, a view for Mina Although it is Mina, but it shows you the Jamara, which is a station that the person go and through the pebbles, okay? On what is supposed to resemble the shaitan, okay? This is called Jamratul Aqaba. And Jamratul Aqaba is in Mina, okay? But this is the city of Mina, and any place in Mina that you can go and spend the night there. And as I said, is no anything that you will perform in this day except to be there and spend the night beside Dhikrullah, reciting Quran, making dua. This is the thing that you should indulge yourself in it. In Mina, the people of who's making Hajj, everybody will shorten his prayer, regardless if this person from the people of Mecca or the people coming out of Mecca. Every person will shorten the prayer. Salat al-Dhuhr will be two, Salat al-Asr will be two, but he doesn't combine the prayer. This is the way how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had did it. Now the next day after he spends the night in Mina, this will be the ninth days, the ninth days of the Hijjah, the last month of the Islamic calendar. In the ninth days, what is the person going to be? After he make Fajr in Mina, and after sunrise, now you prepare yourself and you start to walk and going to Arafah. You don't enter Arafah. You don't enter Arafah. Little bit before Arafah, there is a small town or a small city or whatever station you want to call it. And this is Namira. And it's very, very close to Arafah. And there you will make Zuhr and Asr. You shorten the prayer and you combine the prayer. Okay? In Namira, which is a little bit before Arafah, you will make Zuhr and Asr, shorten the prayer and combine your prayer. It's going to be one Adhan and two Iqama. And a person who's going for Hajj is not supposed to fast. Okay? And this to give him strength. So he will be able to meet this heat and the difficulty and make dua and make dhikr. The fasting for those people who are not performing Hajj. Okay? So you can be in some kind of similarity like your brothers and sisters who's performing Hajj. So a person who performing Hajj, he doesn't perform fasting, okay? And there he will make dua facing the Qibla. When he enter, the Imam will give a khutbah there after you make Dhuhr and Asr and listen to the khutbah. Now you start to enter Arafah, okay? You enter Arafah. Now, a lot of people and any place in Arafah, you should settle yourself there. A lot of people, they fight, they fast, they try to cause themselves hardship to go over the mountain of Arafah. Okay? The mountain of Arafah. As Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went over the mountain Jabal al-Rahmah. The mountain of Rahmah, the mountain of mercy, he stood there and he had informed us that, and he said that I stood here and all Arafah is what? Is a mawqif. All Arafah is a mawqif. So a person does not have to be on top of the mountain. You can be down beside the mountain. It can be in any place in Arafah. This actually is one picture which shows you how crowded it is.
Allahu Akbar.
And like you see, it got like approximately maybe about 8 or 12 highways, all of them same direction, all of them coming from Mina to Arafah. And all of them will be crowded the same way that he sees this picture here. People riding in the buses and all on top of the buses everywhere. And you can see the people who walking they may reach faster than the people who is riding. You can see how crowded it is, okay? And all what you see, all this is a human being. A person will spend the time between Dhuhr until sunset in Arafah. This is another picture here, which shows you one of the sites of Arafah. And you see how much tents there. This is like a temporary city, which will take a place for approximately 5 to 7 hours, and everything will disappear after this. All these tents and all this establishment is nothing but a temporary establishment for a period of 5 to 7 hours maximum. Mountains. The mountain of Jabal al-Rahma, and all what you see, this is tents, and all this is a human being. And this is Jabal al-Rahma, okay? The mark, this white mark that you see it in the top, this is like a mark to show you which mountain. But as I said, you shouldn't be trying to climb the mountain if there's no necessity there. There's no more reward that you be on top of the mountain. In any place in the valley of Muzdalifah, you can be there. A person will be there with no fasting, reciting Quran, making talbiyah, making dhikr, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, any of the things to please Allah. No salah there. No salah in Arafah. In actuality, the person, he prays Dhuhr and Asr before he enter. And he prays Maghrib and Isha later. So all the time that you sitting in Arafah, you indulge only in dua, dhikrullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, istighfar, nothing else, no salah, no any other form of worship except dua, dhikr, reciting Quran, making durood, salah ala Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. After sunset, and as I said, this is the main part, this is the main part of what, of Hajj, to be in Arafah. After sunset, the people will move from Arafah, going back to Muzdalifah, okay? After sunset, you have to be there until sunset. When sunset, now you start moving out of Arafah. Going to where? Going to Muzdalifah. And in Muzdalifah, he will pray Maghrib and Isha, combine them together. The Maghrib will be 3 rak'at, and the Isha will be 2 rak'at. Will be 1 adhan and 2 iqama, okay? And it is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for the person to spend the night in Muzdalifah. You spend the night again in Muzdalifah. And when you spend the night in Muzdalifah, no tahajjud, okay? No qiyam al-layl, no dhikr, nothing. This is the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we shouldn't do beyond the sunnah. We don't know better than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We don't love Allah more than Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Allah had made it this way so for you to rest, you understand? So people make Maghrib and Isha and go sleep, okay? Because you have another day before you. So no tahajjud, no qiyam al-layl, not indulge in any other things. Women, weak people, handicapped, they can leave early, going to Mina. But healthy people, they should be there as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But for the weak people, women, handicapped, before the last end of the night, they can start leave. A person who's healthy, young, He stays there until Salat al-Fajr and make Fajr there, okay? Make Fajr in Muzdalifah. And after this, you will go to another station called Al-Mash'ar al-Haram. And there, you will make Dhikrullah, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Takbir, Subhanallah, Allahu Akbar, Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik, all these things. Until sun rise and became up clear in the sky. And after this, the person will be going to Mina. So we started from Mina, we went Muzdalifah, we went to Arafah, you come back from Arafah to Muzdalifah, and from Muzdalifah again back to Mina. Now, when you go to Mina, you will be in Mina the day of Eid. The day of Eid. This is the day which is the 10th of Dhul Hijjah. So the 8th, he was in Mina. The 9th, he was in Muzdalifah and Arafah. 9th, finish sunset, you go to Muzdalifah. So the 10th in the morning, you will be where? You will be in Mina. Alright? So in actuality, there is main 2 days here. The day of the 9th, which he spent it in Arafah. And the night that he spent in Muzdalifah, and the next day, which is the 10th of the Hijjah, and this is going to be a person in Mina during this time. A person will go Jamrat al-Aqaba. Jamrat al-Aqaba, which is going to be the first Jamra, or the first station that resembles the shaitan closer to Arafah. And the person will throw 7 pebbles. After, he will stop making talbiyah, no more labbaik Allahumma labbaik, and will have 7 pebbles which he's going to throw it on this station, okay, and say Allahu Akbar with each one of it, and I'm going to show you a picture about it inshallah now. Actuality, the bottom one, as well as this one. You can see this, what you call like a building in the middle. There is a big circle, okay? And there is a metal thing sticking in the middle. Do you see it, a building? This metal surrounding building for the pebbles to fall in. You try to, and actually, the pebbles is something small like the chickpeas, no bigger than this, okay? About the size of the chickpeas. Because you have to be careful also, because if it hits somebody, not to hurt him or cause him to bleed. So small pebbles, no bigger more than a chickpeas. And you try to get closer as much as you can without pushing the Muslims. This is something that everybody have to take this in consideration, that we shouldn't be disturbing people during any of the performance of Hajj, okay? Special watching for weak people and women and young kids. And you will go and throw 7 pebbles, Allahu Akbar, with each one, and try to hit this, okay? 7. After the person he throw, this is a station, we don't say this is the shaitan. We say that this, where is the shaitan had met the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam, and he tried to turn him away from fulfilling the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet Ibrahim, he threw pebbles on the shaitan, and we revive the sunnah of the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam. Okay? And this should be also something like a commitment from us when we're doing this, that we do our best, that we be as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, indeed the shaitan is an enemy for you, so take him as an enemy. إن الشيطان لكم عدو فاتخذوه عدوا. Indeed the shaitan is a clear open enemy for you, take him as an enemy. Some people they exceed the limit. Okay, some people they exceed the limit. And they go and they try to go on top of this building and they be using like slippers and 2x4 and try to hit it. This is not the sunnah, this is not the way, okay? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam threw pebbles, and this is what we do. We don't exceed the limits, okay? And hitting it with a sandal or with 2x4, all these things, this is not right, okay? This is not the sunnah. And this also will expose you to danger, because people throw pebbles and will come and can hurt you for being there in the middle. This Jamrat al-Aqaba, which is in Mina. And this is the Aqaba that which you're going to throw the pebbles on it the first day of Eid, okay? The first day of Eid. Now, a person after this, he will go and slaughter the sacrifice, okay? If it's a goat or a lamb or a cow or a camel, and he will shave his hair or shorten his hair. And as I made it clear yesterday, shorten the hair does not mean to take one from here and one from here. The sunnah that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua 3 times for the people who will do what? Will shave their hair. And he made dua 1 time for the people who cut their hair short. So if you want to get the full blessings, you shave your hair. But if you want to make taqseer, does not mean to clip couple of hairs from here and couple of hairs from here. That means to take the clipper and go over all your head. Okay? Now when you do this, this is called tahallul asghar. This is called what? Tahallul asghar. That means you are in the small lawful state. Okay? There is 2 states for you to be things comes back lawful to you and live normal life like before. The first state will be ended by throwing the first jamra. Okay? Now if you throw the first jamra, now you can shave your hair, and now what you can do, you can wear your regular clothes. Because during ihram, during hajj, you could not wear thobe, you could not wear a coat, you could not wear a jacket, you could not wear underwear, you could not wear any of the regular clothes. You have to wear only these 2 pieces of material, okay? So when you throw the first jamra, now you are have the first tahallul. That mean now is lawful for you to wear your regular clothes, okay? What is forbidden? Forbidden for you that you have intercourse with your wife. Now the person after this will go to Mecca. After he already threw the pebbles and he sacrificed his animal, he will go to Mecca. He can do this in the first day or the second day or the third day. If it's too much for him to go immediately, no problem. He can stay in Mina. He can stay in Mina. But if he won't, he will go to Mecca and go make tawaf around the Kaaba. He will go and make tawaf around the Kaaba, and this will be tawaf al-ifada. Okay? Tawaf al-ifada. That after he made the hajj, you will go and go around the Kaaba 7 times. You will start from al-Hajar al-Aswad, which is this corner. Okay? This is a picture here for the black stone. This is a picture here for the black stone. And the black stone is in the corner of the Kaaba. And this is the place where you're supposed to start your tawaf from. Tawaf means going around something, okay? So you will come, and if you can reach to the black stone, you will kiss it, okay? If you could not reach it, you can touch it with your hand or with a stick or whatever you got. If you could not, from a distance from there, and Allahu Akbar, and you start, Bismillah, Allahu Akbar, and you start your tawaf. So you're going to start from here, and you will go around the Kaaba 7 times, okay? After the person will make tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times, I don't have a clear picture to show you Maqam Ibrahim, but this, the golden building that you see it here, is Maqam Ibrahim, or the station of Ibrahim. The person will go there behind the station, and he will pray 2 rak'at, the sunnah, for tawaf. It's not actually, I was looking for a picture. Here maybe is a little bit clearer here in this picture. It's right away, get me the white towel in the car. Here, this right away, on top of my finger, this is Maqam Ibrahim, or the station of Ibrahim. Is a golden glass building, okay, station, which inside the footsteps of the Prophet Ibrahim print is inside the stone. The stone that the Prophet Ibrahim used to stand on it to build the Kaaba. And his footprint, you can see it deep in the stone, approximately about 5 to 6 inches. You can see the footprint in it, okay? And after this, if you can, which I know is very difficult, you will get back again to the black stone, and you will kiss it, and if you can make dua, and the dua, if you look in this picture, you find the people standing after the door of the Kaaba. This is not the sunnah. Okay, this is not the sunnah to be standing there. The sunnah, in actuality, is to stand between the door of the Kaaba and the black stone. This is what you call a multazam. Okay? You see where is the first man? He is in the right place. The first man is in the right place.
In the left.
Mm-hmm. In the left. In actuality, you can do this during other times, not during time of Hajj. Neither in Ramadan. If you go other days, maybe you will be able to be there. And the sunnah, that you go in the multazam, and that you'll be facing, putting your cheek on the wall of the Kaaba. Like you see this man, he's, in actuality, all what he need to do, to turn his face to the left, instead putting his face to the Kaaba. You will stand like this. Okay, so this is the door of the Kaaba as example, okay, and this is the black stone. So the black stone is a corner. So between the corner and the door of the Kaaba, this area called Multazam, okay, from Iltizam, to hug something. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go there, both his cheek on the Kaaba, facing the east like this, and putting his hand on the Kaaba and stand there asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and begging him and making prayer. So this is the way if a person wants to practice the sunnah to go there in this area and to be standing in this manner and to be putting his face as well as his chest on the Kaaba. after you do this, you will go and drink from Zamzam and put water of Zamzam on top of your head, if you can. And you don't have to go downstairs actually, but whatever way that you can get some water of Zamzam, you can have it. After this, the person will go to As-Safa and Marwa to make sa'i, because this is also part of Hajj, okay? And the person will go between Safa and Marwa, and as I said, the mountain of Safa is here, the mountain of Marwa is here, and the building is right away to the left side of the Haram. This is this circle, or what, a cube shape, or whatever you call it, this is the whole Haram. This is the Kaaba in the middle, and the building to the side, this long building. This is the distance that you're going to be walking between to make sa'i. Seven times you're going to go between Safa and Marwa. You can see it here. This is like a small tunnel in the middle for the handicapped in wheelchair. And this, people going back and forth. And it's very important that we follow order, because this makes things more easier on other Muslims. If you try and understand to walk in the opposite direction, it causes a lot of trouble. So you're going to start from Safa, go in the mountain of Safa, make your dua facing the Qibla, the Kaaba, and after this you will walk until you reach to the other side, which is the Marwa. And this will be counted one time. You come back again from Marwa to Safa, and this will be the second time for you. Okay? You continue this three times. In actuality, you're going to be wearing your regular clothes. You are not wearing the ihram anymore. Because you remember we said when you throw the pebbles, now you can what? You can take your ihram off, you can shave your head, you can kill your lamb, and this will be the first tahallul for you. This is again, it shows you Safa. And you can see a little bit out of the hill of or the mountain of Safa, which is, there is some building, modern buildings here now. But this is supposed to be the mountain of Safa, which you start your sa'i. When you reach between the two green lights, okay, there is two marks there, green, you will run, okay? This also to commemorate the memory of Hajar, may Allah be pleased with her, which used to be running there. Alaykum salam Allah. So you go between Safa and Marwa seven times. After you do this, you will return back to Mina. You will return back to Mina, okay? And by making tawaf al-ifada, and making the sa'i for Hajj, now everything lawful for you. Wearing regular clothes, sleeping with your wife, all these things is lawful for you. What is not lawful for you? You could not hunt, you could not cut trees, you could not scare the birds there. Everything in Mecca, you understand, is sacred. And everything there is what? Is safe, secure. Okay? But what has become lawful that was forbidden for you before, that wear regular clothes and sleeping with your wife, this became what? Lawful and permissible for you after you make your tawaf and your sa'i. So if you did not come and make tawaf and sa'i the first day, you make it the second day, the third day, fourth day, that means you have to stay away from your wife. all the spirit. Okay, does not mean you have to sleep in another tent. But this means that you don't have, you don't talk to her about anything like romantic or anything like excitement. So you don't sleep with her in this manner, okay, until you make your tawaf and your sa'i. Now you will return back to your station, which is Mina. And you can see how crowded it is for people going to Mina. Whatever transportation, means of transportation available, you take it. And in Mina will be 3 days that you're going to be there. You have to spend the night. You will be in Mina for 3 days. Okay? Or you can stay there for 4 days. That means the first day of Al-Eid, which is the 10th, and the 11th, and the 12th. If you want to cut it short, there's no problem. You will leave. If you want to stay extra days, it's okay, you can stay there. Okay? Now, after the 4th day, now you leave Mina. You don't stay longer after this. Nobody say, okay, brother, I want to get more blessings, let me stay in Mina. No. The Prophet ﷺ didn't recommend it. Allah said, فَمَنْ تَعَجَّلَ فِي يَوْمَيْنِ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ وَمَنْ تَأَخَّرَ فَلَا إِثْمَ عَلَيْهِ. The person that he won't have 2 days after Eid is no harm for him. A person who wants to delay it for 1 day more is no harm. But after this, you have nothing to do in Mina. Okay? You will go back to Mecca. What you can do in Mecca, you can shopping, you can buy gifts. If you have business, you can deal with your business, or you can spend time in the haram. You can make extra tawaf, you can make dhikr, whatever you want. If you stay for a day, for a week, for a month, this is up to you. Okay? There is nothing else that you can do there in Mecca. Some people, they go, as example, to visit some places. It is not part of Hajj. As example, one of the places you go to visit, this place. This Jabal al-Nur, the mountain of light. And the cave, Ghar Hira. The Ghar Hira, the cave of Hira. This is where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the first revelation, when he used to go away from Mecca, from all these idols and these things, and go and think and reflect about the creation of the heaven and the earth. Okay? So some people, they go there. Some people even go and make 2 rak'at there. This is not sunnah. This has nothing to do with Islam. Okay? It's not recommended. If it's something that for blessings, the Prophet ﷺ will tell us to go there. Okay? And we shouldn't, you understand, try to imitate people about what they're doing without any recommendation from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Is nothing, is no sunnah, is no any recommendation about it, no. That you do it, nothing, no, nothing.
No tradition.
Huh?
No tradition. And it's very high too.
It will take you approximately about hour and a half to reach all the way to this. And there's nothing except a mountain, okay? And big rocks and things like this. So a person will make rak'at, some salah in the haram, which each salah you pray there, 100,000 times rewarded. More than for you to go to the mountain and say, okay, I want to see this and get the reward and make 2 rak'at there. This is not recommended, it's not part of the sunnah of the Prophet. But making tawaf and making salah in the Kaaba there, it much rewarded than anything else. If the person finish and he want to leave to his country or leave to the Medina, he can do so. Oh, excuse me, I missed something very important. What the person will do in Mina in the 3 days? In each day, the person will go to the 3 stations that resemble the shaitan and will throw each one with 7 pebbles. Okay? After sun, after the sun moved from the middle of the sky, like Dhuhr time, okay? Every day you will go the first and the middle and the last. You will go to each one and throw 7 pebbles here, like you see it here. And there is another one here. You see, they build 2 floors. There is 1 floor down, and there is 2 floor because it's too crowded. And there is a column in the middle here. And you see, this big pile, this is nothing but pebbles. And like, you see how crowded it is. So you have to be very careful and concerned about the Muslims who's there. Every day that you are in Mina, you will go to these 3 stations after Zohar, and you will throw in each one 7 pebbles. And the time is from Zohar until sunset. This is the time that you're supposed to do this. Okay?
This is for healthy young men.
If the person decides to go to Medina or to go back to his country, now one thing is left to do. What it is? Something called Tawaf al-Wada'. Okay? The, what you call,
farewell.
Farewell, Tawaf. Walaykum as-salam wa rahmatullahi. That means before you leave, like you say to somebody goodbye or assalamu alaikum, that the same thing will be applied before you leave. You will make what? You will make tawaf around the Kaaba 7 times. No sa'i. No sa'i. Only tawaf. You make tawaf and you leave. Now you can leave to Jeddah, you can leave to your country, you can leave wherever you want to leave. Some people, they will like to go and visit the Medina. In actuality, if you're going to visit Medina, your intention not for visiting the Medina, neither the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because visiting the Medina or visiting the grave is no reward for it. Neither is recommended. What is recommended? That you go and pray in the mosque of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The 3 masjid that the Prophet ﷺ told us, a person can initiate a trip or make a journey for it. Otherwise, all the masjid are equal in the reward. You shouldn't, as example, leave the masjid of Colombia, going to pray in the masjid of Orangeburg because you will get more reward. Or leave the masjid of Orangeburg, going to Augusta to pray there because more reward. All the masjids are equal in the reward of the Salah, except the 3 masjid. The Masjid al-Aqsa in Jerusalem. And each prayer he prayed there, the reward is what? 500 prayer. The second masjid is the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which for each Salah there, 1,000 Salah. Okay, for each salah that you make it there is what? 1,000 salah. And the third masjid that you should make special trip for it is al-Masjid al-Haram, which in Mecca, and the salah is there is rewarded with what? With 100,000 prayer. This is some picture for the masjid of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Here what you see, the minarets and the green dome. And if the person goes there, the first thing is that you should start with is praying 2 rak'at. Some Muslims, the first thing when they enter the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they go to greet the Prophet. The first thing that you enter the masjid is 2 rak'at. Okay? This is another view for the mass of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And after this, in your place, wherever you are, is no necessity, or if you want to go, this is the grave of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This actually is like some kind of what you may call like a fence, or what you call this, I don't know if the proper way to use fence is like
a gate.
A gate, maybe we say a gate, okay? On the room. Which is, this is the room which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to live in it, and it is what, where if the Prophet died, where is supposed to be his grave, okay?
What next to him? What next to the Prophet?
Besides that, you don't see really anything except this metal gate. You could not see anything inside, but inside is also Abu Bakr as-Siddiq, may Allah be pleased with him, radiallahu anhu, as well as Umar. So this we call it al-muwajaha, the facing, okay? That where is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, assalamu alaikum. It's no special thing really to say it there, except like a person to say, as-salamu ala rasul sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What you see here is a place where is a member of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the grave. And the Prophet ﷺ had told us that between his house and his member is like a place from paradise, rawdatun min riyadil jannah. Some people between the grave and the member, this is not correct. Between the house and the member, this you understand where is, you call it rawda sharifa, okay, which is like a place of paradise, okay, and usually it's very, very, very crowded, except if you go in a places in times not like Ramadan, no Rabi', no Hajj, you may be able to get there and you can perform 2 rak'at. So in actuality, let's make this clear, if somebody had made Hajj, if any person made Hajj and didn't go to Medina, his Hajj is completed. Visiting the Medina or visiting the mosque of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or visiting the mosque of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has nothing to do with the Hajj. Okay, the Hajj is consist of standing in Arafah, being in Mina, throwing the pebbles, okay, and spending 3 nights in Mina, making tawaf around the Kaaba, and making sa'i between Safa and Marwa. Okay? This is the basic pillars of Al-Hajj. If you go to Medina or you don't go to Medina, this has nothing to do with this. Okay? Let's make this clear. One thing that I want, we talked about it yesterday, we talked about ihram yesterday. The ihram, as I said, is preferably for the man to be something white. Not only for ihram as well as our regular clothes. Is not a must, but is recommended. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said the best of your thobes or the best of your wearing is white. Wear it in your dunya life and also wrap yourself in it when you die, okay? As I said, for the woman is no special clothes, no special kara for ihram. But is recommended something like this. If the person could not find this color and found any other color, is no problem, he can wear it. This like a towel or beach towel or whatever you want to call it. Regular towel. Okay? And the person after you take a full shower, first of all, that you're going to cut your fingernails, okay, toes, all the things, You shave hair like private parts under your arms, not your beard, because this is forbidden to shave your beard at any time. After you shave and you do these things, and that you put perfume, now you will wear the ihram. And when you wear the ihram, you don't wear any clothes under it, okay? No long johns, no sirwal, no pants, no underwear, nothing. The ihram is two pieces. I didn't have a chance to get the other piece, okay? But it's two pieces. And now, you use one for the bottom part of your body, and one for the, what you call, the upper part. One for the lower part, and one for the lower part. Nothing under this. Is this understood? Not even underwear, and this for the man. Some people, they understand mukhit and mahit. What is mukhit? They said you could not wear mukhit. Say, if anything been sewn in it, you could not wear it. No, this is not correct. Sewn clothes, that mean regular clothes, like what you wear. This is what you call sewn clothes. But this one, as example, if this thread will be coming out and your wife will take it and hem it for you, there's no problem with it. This is sewn, but this is not what been meant in the hadith, okay? Al-makhit is what you regularly wear, like a shirt, or a pants, or a thobe. Muhit, some people say you could not wear a belt because this will be round. Muhit, something go round. No, the muhit is like you put round yourself regular like a turban. Now, when you do this, this is called muhit because it goes round you. This is turban. A person who's making umrah or hajj, he doesn't wear a turban. Neither he wear a kufi. Okay, nothing on your head. So you will take this first part. And as I said, it's no problem for you to put a belt. But it is very easy, you can wear it without a belt. It's a matter to know how to do it. Okay? Now you can do it like this. And you can go around like it. You can bring it again. Now turn it. Turn it. Now you can try, come and pull it from me, it's not going to fall. Some people will be scared that it's going to fall, especially you don't have any clothes now. And you can wear, walk, it's not any problem. Okay? This is already there, it's not going any place. Okay? You can even use it for putting your little bit of money, change bucket with you, if you want. Like, money like this, you put it, turn it, turn it, turn it. You can do whatever, it's not going any place, the money's not going to fall. Okay? And it's very easy to walk in it. Maybe I have to take this off to show you.
Uh-oh. How about on the top?
I will come into the top. To make it more easier for you to walk, okay? Because some people, they put it so tight, they don't know how, like this, okay? They don't know how to walk. Leave it loose. Take it a little bit like this, here. This is to give you more room. And now you can tie. Okay? Because this will allow you more room. Go back with it. Come. Okay? Because this way, it will give you more room that you can walk. You can put it to the side. It's no problem. Okay? Take two sides together. Okay? Come back. Turn it. Okay? It's no problem. This is basically here. Now, it's not any clothes under this now. This is all what you're wearing. The top, another piece. But since I only, this one piece I have with me now, I'm going to use it. So the top piece, you only bought it like this. You don't bought it like this. Nothing on your head while you're making ihram. While you are in clothes of ihram, making umrah or making hajj. Now this piece is going to go like this, okay? This piece will go like this. Now you can, if you have this bottom piece, now you can push this in. So your navel not to be exposed, because the navel from here is our private parts for you. You have to cover this, all right? And this can go like this. Or you can have it, round you completely right, like this. Okay? Now only when you enter the haram, when you enter the haram, you just come in and you're going to make the first tawaf, now you're going to put it like this. You don't put it like this from the moment you leave New York until you go to Jeddah. Okay? You don't have to. The only time you expose the shoulder is in the beginning of your Umrah, when you're already there in the Haram and you're going to go around the Kaaba. You understand? And what I was talking yesterday about Ramal around the Kaaba, the first three, you go like this. This is what you call Ramal, okay? This is the Sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. While what? Your shoulder is exposed. And after you finish, now when you're making Sa'i as example, this is back regular, everything is regular. Only the first tawaf, this will be down like this, when the first. Okay? Is this clear, except understood? Now there's nothing here on the head, okay? And you have the other piece down, and this is all what you're dressing. No socks, no underwear, no t-shirt. Is this clear? Is understood? Okay. So let's assume now I'm coming from New York. I'm going to make Hajj. When I wear this, in New York or in Colombia? In the aeroplane, approximately, let's say, a half an hour before you arrive to Jeddah, this is your station. They will announce it in the aeroplane telling you, you're approaching now, put your ihram, make make your umrah or prepare yourself, make your intention. So this moment you will put your clothes, okay? And as I said yesterday, it's no sunnah for tawaf. It's no two rak'at sunnah. If you just finish salah, now you can make the ihram after it. You wear it and you say, labbaik umrah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik, labbaik la sharika laka labbaik, inna alhamda wa ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika laka. And you start to get yourself involved in dhikr, subhanallah, alhamdulillah, labbaik Allahumma labbaik. You go to Jeddah, you go to take your passport all this time, you be waiting, and after this, when you arrive there, you're going to what? Put this down like this, and you're going to start what? Bismillah Allahu Akbar, in front of the black stone. Bismillah Allahu Akbar, Bismillah Allahu Akbar, and you start going around the Kaaba. 7 times, okay?
Counterclockwise.
So the Kaaba will be in your left side. When you come to the corner, this is a black stone here, okay? When you come to this corner, if you can reach it, you do what? Say Bismillah, say Allah, Bismillah Allahu Akbar. If you could not reach it, you don't wave, you do nothing. You keep walking. Between these two corners, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار خلنا الجنة مع الأبرار برحمتك يا عزيز يا غفار. When you come to the black stone, if you can kiss it, you will kiss it. If you could not, you understand, you try to touch it. If you could not touch it, you say what? Bismillah Allahu Akbar from a distance and keep going, okay? And you keep for the first three. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar. Subhanallah, whatever that you want to say. Okay, Rabbana atina fi dunya. After the three, okay, is finished. Now, everything, you walk regular now, and you put, Subhanallah, Allahumma afilli, ighfirli for my parents, oh Allah guide me. Whatever that you want, say it, okay? And after you, now I finish in the last, I start from here, the black stone, so I will end where? The black stone. How many?
Seven.
Now, after I finish this, here, after the black stone, here will be what? The station of Ibrahim, Maqam Ibrahim. So I will come here, okay, and do what? I will make two rak'at, the sunnah of tawaf. Now, after I finish this, if I can go again to the black stone, it's fine, and kiss it. If I could not, I will go to where Safa and Marwa, which will be almost directly. You see, where is the black stone? So if you go straight there in the Safa and Marwa, will be like this, and this is the Kaaba here. So if I stand like this on the Safa and Marwa, I will see the Kaaba. And from there I understand, I make my dua, and after this I will start walking. This will be one time, and go to the Marwa, come back will be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and there will be the end of my tawaf.
My
sa'i. Mm-hmm. Okay? And now I come and will do what? Shave this or cut it, and this will be what? This is the finish of
Umrah.
Now I will go take this off now, okay? Put my regular clothes, enjoy myself, relax, everything's fine, and I wait until what?
The 8th of the day.
The 8th of Dhul Hijjah. When the 8th of Dhul Hijjah come, I will do what again? Take this regular clothes, get my ihram again, okay? And put the other piece, not like this, like this, okay? And labbayka hajj, because I already finished Umrah. Now do what? Labbayka hajj. Oh Allah, I'm here for you as you command me with hajj. لبيك اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. Take my car, go with my companion or whosoever, go to where? To Mina. Today is what?
The 8th.
Okay? And in Mina what I'm going to do? Salat al-Zuhr, 2 rak'at, and go back to my tent. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, dhikr, read Quran, whatever it is. لبيك اللهم لبيك. Time for عصر. You come out in the jama'at, make عصر. Anything else? Nothing. Until what? The next day. You get up, you make fajr, and after this you start to prepare to go to where? To go to Arafah. Now, I'm going to Arafah, and before Arafah, there is what? Muzdalifah, which is very, very close. And there I will make dhuhr, and make Asr, all right? And after this, I will enter Arafah. In Arafah, you can be standing, you can be sitting, you can be leaning, whatever, doesn't matter. But indulge yourself from this moment until sunset in dua, dhikr, istighfar, whatever that you can do.
Some people, they misunderstood wukuf in Arafah.
Wukuf does not mean this, what I'm saying, does not mean wukuf to be standing up. You can be inside the tent, you can be under the tree, you can be wherever it is, you don't have to go all the way to the top of the mountain. But you have to be in the premises of Arafah. You remain in Arafah until what? Sunset. Okay? Until sunset. Now sunset, leave Arafah and go back to where? To Muzdalifah. Do what there? Salat al-Maghrib. Assalamu alaikum. Salat al-Isha. Assalamu alaikum. What after this? Go sleep, relax. Sleep. Okay? Get up, make fajr, and start moving. Go to al-Mash'ar al-Haram, making dhikrullah. And after sunrise, now we start to go to what? This today is what? Today is the day of Eid now. This is the 10th. The 10th of Dhul Hijjah. Is the day after Arafah immediately. Okay? And now I go to where? To go to Mina. When I go to Mina, what I do? I will go to the Jamra, the station where is supposed to resemble the Shaitan. Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar 7 times. Throwing the pebbles. And after this what? Shave it. Take this off now. And what? Go kill your lamb, your goat, whatever it is, and now you can have your regular clothes. Okay? How many days you going to be there? 3 or 4?
Did you make the tawaf ifadah?
How many days? 3 or 4?
Now you have in the first day or the second, the third or any day before you can go to what? You go to Mecca. When you go to Mecca, what you're going to do? You're going to have your regular clothes because you already throw the first Jamrat al-Aqaba and you already shaved, you kill your lamb. So now you can have your regular clothes now. Now when you go, you will go to the Haram and you go around the Kaaba, Tawaf al-Ifada, the Tawaf after coming from Arafah. 7 times, the same manner, the same way. After this, you will go Safa and Marwa 7 times, and then no shaving now because you already shaved and you have your regular clothes. Mm-hmm. Okay? Now after I finish this, if this is the first day of Eid, return where? To Mina again. Return in Mina. Do what? Nothing but dhikrullah. And eating from your sacrifice and enjoy the company and dhikrullah. After Dhuhr, I go to the 3 stations. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, and it's through the people 7 times. And you go to the second one, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, 7 times. And you go to the third one, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And after this, go back to your tent or wherever it is, and you spend the night. The second day, and the third day, and the fourth day the same way. And this will be Hajj. May Allah bless you all, inshallah, with Hajj.
Amen.
I know it's not easy to understand all these things in one time, but at least you're getting some general idea how people perform in Hajj. You can go over the tape and the pictures, you can see it more and read more about it, and inshallah this will give you more understanding about it. This here shows you the different stations between Mecca and Mina and Arafah and Muzdalifah and all these places that the person will pass by it in his during the period of Hajj. If anybody have a question or anything that is not cleared, or if I made a mistake while I'm saying, please feel free to ask or to comment about it.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
Since you talk mostly about Hajj Tamattu, I was wondering, you mentioned shaving your head twice. Is that my understanding? Is that correct?
The first time that you shaved because was Umrah. And in actuality, there is a time between Umrah and Hajj. Sometimes can be a week, sometimes can be 2 weeks.
Right.
And Al-Hajj Ashhurun Ma'lumat. Indeed, the Hajj is a specific month. So it starts from Ramadan, Shawwal, Dhul Qa'dah, Dhul Hijjah. Okay? So some people, they go and they make Umrah in Shawwal. And they sit after this for 2-3 months waiting for the Hajj. Some people, there is a period of 1 week only. So it's already another hair there in your head. Even if it's nothing, a person will pass the razor blade over his...
That was my question.
Yeah. Will be some hair there, inshallah. It's very hot there and it's going to come, even if it doesn't come, will be coming. Any question? Any comments, any correction, anything?
One more question, inshallah. When you're doing tawaf, you say, you make the dua, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirah. You do that all 7 times, right?
Yes, and every time you come in between the Rukn Yamani and the black stone, this one you say this.
The ayah, Rabbana atina fid dunya hasanah wa fil akhirah hasanah wa qina adhaban.
Yeah, as I said yesterday, this is a verse in Quran, which in Surah number 2, verse 201. Oh Allah, grant us the God of this life and the God of the hereafter. Yes, sir.
The sacrificing of the animal, does that take the place of when Abraham?
Exactly.
Was going to...
The sacrifice, the udhiyah, okay, the udhiyah is what it takes the place of showing appreciation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saves the Prophet
Ishmael. But what you do there is not the sacrifice. It is a part of the Hajj actions. And a person who could not do this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, فَمَنْ تَمَتَّعَ بِالْعُمْرَةِ الْحَجِّ فَمَنْ لَمْ يَجِدْ فَصِيَامُ ثَلَاثَةِ أَيَّامٍ فِي الْحَجِّ وَسَبْعَ إِذَا رَجَعْتُمْ. A person who doesn't have the means to make this sacrifice, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, let him fast 3 days during Hajj and 7 days when he come back. So this has nothing to do with the sacrifice that we do it, that we people were not during Hajj, okay? But what you do there as a is part of the rituals of the Hajj and the things that you command to do it. Is a part of must, like you make tawaf and you make sa'd, you have to kill this animal. But if you don't have the means, that you're going to fast 3 days while you are there and 7 when you come back home.
I know that after the day of Eid, after you come back from Muzdalifah, you go into Mina to throw the stones to Jamrat al-Aqaba, which is the closest to Mecca. So you pass through the first one and the second one and the third one, which is the Jamrat al-Aqaba.
Yeah, I have it here. Any, can you get this? It's a bit, wow. Got it, brother?
Yeah.
See, Akhi, I would like you to, if you can get this what you call it, this shows you where is Mecca and the Haram, okay, assuming that this is Mas'a and this is Mecca and this is the Haram. So the closer one to the Haram is the Aqaba, the Kubra, and after this is Wusta, and after this is Sughra. So Sughra is the one that closer more to Arafah. If we can get this diagram, you see? It's supposed to, the right side here shows you where is the Haram, the Kaaba, the Safa and Marwa. And this is like going to Arafah. So, and between Mecca and Arafah, which is Mina there, that you have 3 stations, okay? The 3 stations that you throw the pebbles, which is supposed to resemble the shaitan. So you see that Arafah is here. So the one is closer to Arafah is the Sughra, the small. And after this, the middle. So Al-Aqaba al-Kubra, which is closer more to the Haram. But in actuality, you could not help it there, because you're talking about million or two millions or 3 millions doing the same thing at the same time. So you could not be going one direction and everybody else going one. Even if you found some 10,000 of people doing something wrong, you can imagine and understand 1 million doing something right. So you will find yourself, like say you're going with the flow, you could not help it. Everybody going this way to make the throwing the pebbles, so you're going to find yourself automatically, even if you don't know which one first. You found everybody going this way, you could not be walking in the opposite direction. Yeah.
It is, as I said yesterday, it's very, very crowded, more than what we imagine that that we ever saw something crowded. No way. It's something is beyond our imagination. This is the general view for the Haram and the Kaaba and the city of Mecca. This shows you the whole mosque of Al-Haram and the side. This is a long building. This is supposed to be the Safa and Marwa, and shows you all these buildings. Because some people, they think Mecca look like a village or a small town there. It has like 15 floors and 25, all kind of buildings that you cannot imagine, okay? And Alhamdulillah, the road between Mecca and between Jeddah, which is the airport, and Mecca, is asphalt and bridges and marks, almost like a highway that here in the United States. I think even it's done by American people. And this is showing you part of the airport and some of the. This is a Saudi airline. 747 or whatever you call it, point, or I don't know how they call it, but this jumbo, one of the aeroplanes that takes people there. So it's not, you understand, like you're taking a city bus. It's a sophisticated transportation and big airport and all kind of things there. But as I said, the only transportation is between the airport Jeddah and the Mecca is only buses and taxi and things like this. No aeroplane goes there to Mecca. No train, no subway, nothing like this.
How about over?
Nothing over, nothing under. Any question? And this is little of a lot. The only thing is to experience it, and inshallah, that all of us, we should have the intention that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as soon as He give us the opportunity to do it, that we should go. Because this is one of the five pillars of Islam. And as soon as a person gets the means, now he required to go and he's going to be responsible, because we don't know. Because health comes and goes, okay? Money comes and goes. You don't know. So whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the opportunity, don't say, oh, let me wait until I be 40 or when I get a little bit older. You don't know if you're going to be older. No, Allah knows best when you're going to die. So we should take the opportunity as soon as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to us. Any question? Yes.
Is there anything special that people who aren't in here do, like just regular Muslims during the Hajj?
Is there anything what?
Special, like something different than, you know, what we usually do.
Oh, for us?
Yeah, for us.
People who are not making Hajj?
Not making Hajj.
Is nothing special except the day of Arafah to fast. To fast the day of Arafah, and this is recommended by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But it has been encouraged by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that we increase our ibadah and do our more good deed during these 10 days. But it's nothing specially like you have to read the whole Quran or you have to make you understand 20 rak'at every night. But in general, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recommended that we, as inshallah we hear tomorrow on Khutbah al-Jum'ah, that we should make more good deed during these days. This will be, inshallah, and the best thing also after fasting, the 9th, is to sacrifice animal in the 10th, which is the day of Eid. This is the best deed also that you do in that day.
I was going to ask you a question about the sacrifice. Is it true that you have to do it personally for your family? If you make niyyah to do sacrifice, then you have to do it personally, or somebody else can do it for you?
It is much better and recommended that you do it, but if you could not do it for some means, like let's assume that you work in this day or you could not go, you can let somebody do it in your behalf. Still accept it and still good, alhamdulillah. So inshallah we close here and we praise that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted this humble presentation and that make it a reminder for all of us. Hopefully also that we think about this Hajj and take the matter serious, prepare for it through seeking knowledge, prepare lawful means, halal money for it, and try to jump in the first opportunity that Allah gave it to us. And we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the opportunity to make Hajj, inshallah, all. And we close them by saying, Subhanakallah wa bihamdik. نشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك عند الله سبحانه وتعالى نزل بس جزاكم الله خيرا